the Joan Quinn Profiles. As an editor for Andy Warhol's Interview, the Los Angeles Herald Examiner, LA Style, and Detour magazines, Joan covered the social set, the Hollywood hotshots, the international art scene, the mysteries of food, the excitement of travel, and the fabulous world of fashion. Joan continues to find creative people on the cutting edge who make things happen. Here's Joan Agajanian Quinn.
Hi, I'm Joan Quinn, and welcome to the Joan Quinn Profiles. Thanks for watching us today. Waiting in the studio to be profiled is artist Deryck Healey and author Shawn Considine. Deryck Healey was born in South Africa and attended the Manchester School of Art. He was honored with the Queen's Award to Industry and the Royal Society of Arts Medal for Art and Design. He served on the Craft Council Board as well. Deryck Healey has been exhibited in England, Germany, France, Italy, and the United States. You're represented in Santa Monica by the Copland Gallery. Does the gallery have any kind of input on what art they want you to show?
Well, she's usually shocked. She comes in and she says, oh, I didn't expect this.
So you know, actually do what you want to do.
Absolutely. But then I do that with all the galleries, all the exhibitions I have. Because the work works in a series, and it's like links in a chain, and each exhibition is totally different to the previous exhibition.
But they all do link together?
Yes, they link together. It's all about identity and horizons and doorways and going through into space.
But are they installations, or can people buy the pieces?
People do buy the pieces. Well, yes. I mean, Donald Hess, Napa,
Napa collection?
He has, I think, 20-odd pieces.
But do you buy them as a group, or are they sold separately when you talk about installation?
Well, some installations are very large, and then they're sold as one big installation.
I see.
Otherwise, they're sold as separate. But we always set up the exhibition to look like an installation.
So the installation that was in the Copland Gallery was about...
What? Now, that was... The separate pieces.
Those are separate pieces.
So there's the separate pieces, but they create an installation point of view, because you come in and you see a lot of work together, which in fact goes together. It's like an educational process.
And it's called Masterclass.
Masterclass.
Which is great. And those are the masters that you talk about.
Well, it starts as Michelangelo being the first master.
And we have the master
yes,
of
we
David.
Have it.
We have... him
cast,
here. We
yes.
have the cast of David. And so how does it, just tell us the process.
Well, the process is, it's amusing. I was driving up La Brea, and we saw this David head along with a lot of other plaster casts on the corner in front of like a petrol station and a liquor store.
Mm-hmm.
And it related to a previous installation I did 3 years before, where I used airport art done by Africans.
Oh.
And so what I wanted to do is make, and what struck me with the David is that it's the most important sculpture and reproduced sculpture in the world. And it has gone to the level of kitsch.
But it's gone to all different sizes as well.
Charm bracelets, keyrings.
Right.
Everything.
And was this head of David that you started with that size?
It was exactly that head. Head on the stand that was at this little corner shop.
So how many of them did you buy?
I bought 21.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, I ordered 21. The next stage was using the David's head as a metaphor. As a master class thing.
And the master is
Leonardo.
Leger.
And then I take Leger, or one of the 20th century masters, and superimpose it onto the David head so that the identities of all 21 are exactly the same. They're all David's heads, all on the same pedestal, all with the same standard doorway.
Oh, the doorway leans against the wall.
Yes.
Oh, I see.
The doorway is the way through for the artist's identity.
I see.
And in this particular instance with the Leger, it's a camouflage. It's about the artist camouflaging.
I see. And then we have this one.
Miro. And a Miro, it's very interesting that this particular Miro, which was in the Sotheby's catalog, belonged to Alexander Calder. And it's, so you could see the shapes. They sort of float.
And I'm going to show the whole
piece. Yes, there's the whole pieces. So it's a whole figure that I've incorporated the pedestal plus the bust. The idea is that there are three things. A pedestal, which is about putting the master on a pedestal.
Uh-huh.
It's about achievement. All these artists' work, they achieve over $1 million at auction. So they all become really very important.
Well, does the auction, you talk about the auction catalog, is that what you use?
I use references out of the auction catalogs because all the works were in private hands.
I'm going to do this the opposite way.
Okay.
I'm going to show the Rothko this way, the whole piece.
Yes, there you go.
And this was also...
There's several. Now, that's taken from several Rothkos because Rothko never did one quite like that. And so what I've done is I've taken the base as one, the back, the doorway as another, and then the head is, in fact, two different Rothkos.
I see. Who else did you include in that
group? I've done Alexander Calder. I've done de Kooning. I've done Andy Warhol. I've done, there are 15 altogether.
Ah.
So it's been very exciting because it's a learning process for me.
And when you talk about going through the door, I see this painting we have on the set also is a doorway.
Yes.
Is it?
It is a doorway. I call all my work visual poems. And the whole idea is that it's about bringing someone to a point to depart.
I see.
So the whole idea is bringing them to a point where they feel they can go through into a space beyond.
And so are all of these doorway paintings the same size, the
exactly
same doorways?
The same size, the same doorway, the same arch. I want it almost to appear that as if the arch is burning itself into the sky, into the background.
So all the skies turn out to be different colors.
Different sunsets, yes.
Sunrises.
Depending on where you want to go, you see.
Oh, I see.
How you want to go, you know, where you want to go to. It's about poetry.
What medium do you use?
This is oil. Oil on paper.
And what about the
those are acrylic. Davids? They are acrylic on plaster, on wood, and on standard doors.
Oh, and is it a standard door?
It's
size?
A standard door.
Ah.
It's, no, I wanted it to be a door, and I wanted them just to lean against the wall in the gallery.
I
don't want them to be fixed like paintings.
I see.
The whole thing is about a process. Of,
I see.
This was that artist's doorway.
What other materials do you use?
Well, I've used marble, glass, neon. I use whatever I feel would be the best medium for the particular subject.
When you were using marble, you were in Pietrasanta, which
yes
is so wonderful. And so many artists go there, don't they?
Absolute bliss. Absolutely. I went to Pietrasanta because of meeting a Los Angeles artist. And they said they were carving marble. It's Lucille Garfield, and she's carving marble. And she said, wouldn't you like to go? And I said, well, I'd never carved marble, but I'd love to go. And I went.
Oh,
she phoned me up, and I went. And it was absolutely magic.
She's great.
She's
I love
wonderful
Lucille.
Yeah, she's a lovely person. Well, she got me to Pietrasanta, and my first exhibition, big major exhibition in London, was all the marble I did in Pietrasanta.
Is that right? Now, we've talked about two or three of the installations. Another one was all black.
Are blackheads white?
Are blackheads white?
Are blackheads white? Yeah, that's a very important one for me because it's about identity again. It's the same subject as this David one,
uh-huh,
but it's about does it matter what color your skin is? It depends on who you are. And so it was about using airport art, African sculptures.
Oh, that was the one. So
yeah,
you use small pieces?
Yeah, small pieces and put them on little plinths.
And
they were coming out of their frame, out of their prisons. And the prisons were like enormous thumbprints for identification. So you had them coming out.
Another one, Poems to My Other Self.
Poems to My Other Self. Yeah, that's the whole idea with all of these is about trying to inspire the viewer to create their own poetry.
Uh-huh.
Why I like to say visual poems, it's so that in interpretation of poems or in music, the person who's listening or hearing it or reading it then has another interpretation. And each time you read it, you can see different things.
Did you write the poetry?
I wrote poetry for some installations that I used in a very large installation in England, in Fosbury, where we had these enormous metal cones and things.
That's another thing. If you have, say, all heads are
Or Blackhead's White.
Oh, Blackhead's White, or Poems to My Other Self.
Yeah.
Would you do that in one gallery and it would be one kind of work, and then would you do it in another gallery with the same title?
Or No, never. I've never had two. I mean, I must have had about 12 or 15 exhibitions now across Europe, but I've never had the same exhibition.
Oh, I see. So it's every not a series of works.
They linked.
They link, I see.
They link.
So meditation works.
Meditation works. I mean, it's the same. It's exactly the same thing. It's about inspiring somebody to think differently and to look at themselves differently.
And are they paintings?
Paintings.
Those
yes.
are paintings.
Yes, those paintings. Neon portraits are very interesting.
Which one is that?
Now, neon portraits.
Is it called neon portraits?
It's called neon portraits. And it was an exhibition I had in Paris. And it was like, if I was to do your portrait, and we were discussing portraits earlier, you would give me major numbers, your birthday, your credit card number or bank number, your passport number, identification numbers. Now, these numbers, you can't travel anywhere in the world without. And whereas in the 18th century, it was painting portrait.
Exactly, you carry
it. Yes, in the end of the 19th, 20th century, it was photography. But now, I say, you can't move anywhere without your numbers.
So how does the portrait
turn? So it works by me making the you give me the numbers, and I order them in neon. So your numbers are ordered in neon, and as you go into your house, they glow with the color you've chosen.
That's fabulous.
And so the people who come in are influenced by the color
That's
of your
great.
Color.
That's great.
So I think you should have one.
So I think we should all be numbers. That's the other thing.
Well,
I think something more interesting is water equals life.
And water equals life.
That sounded very good to
me. Well, that was another very, very, very big installation, which in fact was an installation we did for Switzerland, where Donald Hess has a water, he does bottled water. And he sponsored this project, which in fact, the first phase was this maze of water. The second stage was building a dozen wells across Africa to provide the areas where the Africans could reunite.
Did you actually do that?
Oh, I actually did. So, I mean, Water Equals Life is about how we see water in Switzerland. We see it for drinking, we see it as disposable for playing in, you know, for swimming pools and things. But in fact, in Africa, that same piece of art that I created for Switzerland, would in fact, they would want to drink it.
Yes.
So what we did is created wells that held the community together so that it wouldn't disperse.
When you started doing this this is very cerebral work.
Yes.
Did you start doing it in a group? Did you ever work in a group?
I've never worked in a group. I've always worked people help me, like Jeremy Wiltshire, he helps me.
But I mean, is like a collaboration?
Collaboration, not so much. Not
That's
so
interesting
much.
Because it's all only these ideas come to you yourself and then you build them?
Yes, they over years and years.
Because
Blackhead's White took 10 years.
But you have a design background, it seems.
Absolutely. My art school background, when I left art school, I became a color consultant.
That's right. That's why I was wondering
Award was to do with my color consultancy.
But did you want to be an artist then, or was that all part of
I've
being an artist?
I've always wanted to be an artist since
yes?
a baby.
Really?
Oh, no. Always. But I had to, you know, when you go finish art school, you can't always get a job.
And
nobody wants to buy anything, so,
yes.
you know, so you can't sell any paintings or designs. So you end up doing a job, and I was mixing color in a wallpaper factory.
I see.
And so that's how I started my first sort of design studio.
I see. That's where I was wondering if other people had come into your work, but you were working at that point.
Oh, yes.
With other people.
Oh, no, my design studio, we employed over 70 people.
I see. Have you ever taught?
Oh, yes, I love teaching. Well, this David exercise, this masterclass, is about teaching.
Ah.
It's about learning through somebody else.
Uh-huh.
I have to put myself into the character and of each of these artists and try and turn myself into that artist for one piece only.
Before we leave, tell us what the next link will be.
Oh, the next link is about nuclear power stations. And we all I'm afraid it's already in work because I've got an exhibition in November in England.
So that's what we'll... I think it's been wonderful.
Oh, and my book, and my book.
Oh, your book. Tell me about your book quickly.
The book is fantastic. The book is Open Studio, and it's about all these works and how they link together.
Oh, that's what we need to know.
And that's what you really need to know.
That's what we need to know. Yes. But you've opened so many doors for us and made us able to pass through them, Deryck, and we thank you very much for being with us.
Great pleasure.
Thank you.
Great pleasure.
Don't go away, because we'll be right back with Shawn Considine.
Thank you very much.
Hi, I'm Joan Quinn, and we're back with author Shawn Considine. Shawn was born in Brooklyn and raised in Ireland. He's a journalist whose work has appeared in the New York Times, the LA Times, and newspapers across America. He's also written books about very strong people: Barbara Streisand, Betty Davis, Joan Crawford, and for Random House, a book about Patty Chayefsky, the screenwriter. Shawn, did you enjoy writing for newspapers or writing biographies?
Biographies. There's more freedom, much more freedom, and more money, and more creative control, which all those people want. We all do.
Well, the when you write about the people in your biographies, do they want control?
Well, sure. Barbara Streisand wanted control, and that was the big problem there.
Did you ever meet her?
Yes. I had worked at Columbia Records for 10 years during the 60s, so I also coordinated all her albums and her singles. So I knew all those great stories that are in that book.
Did you know her personally, or were
no,
you just
nobody
not a...
knows her personally, not even her husband's, I don't think, you know. on a professional level, yeah. I was at the recording sessions, so I knew all the control stories, as they say. And there's a lot of funny stories in that book. But she always wanted control. Even on TV Guide 2 weeks ago, I did that story, and she wanted control of that. Actually, she tried to get me fired from that.
Did she call you? Does she call you?
No.
How do you know she wants control?
They call TV Guide, her manager, Marty Ehrlichman.
They go behind your back, in other words.
Oh, I'm only the writer. They went to the top on that. But she did want, she did ask on the book, on the biography, at the last minute. I had been after her 2 years, and she said she was going to sit down, and she was making Yentl at the time. And she was going to sit down and talk to me, because I had done a cover story for People magazine on her. I had met her in Phoenix. I did that cover story.
So you had done extensive interviews.
Oh, yeah.
With
met
her
and hello, and, you know, and she was going to sit down, but she didn't.
And then at the end, does she send you letters? Does she call
you? No, her lawyers send letters to the lawyers.
That went on to my lawyer?
That went on for 10 months. I mean,
is that
her quote was she was going to bury me in the book when the book came out.
Well, when the book came out,
the book came out, and it came out in L.A., and I got a wonderful review from the Los Angeles Times, and I was told she read that and went ballistic.
So she didn't like it, or she liked it?
She didn't like it. She didn't like it.
So it doesn't matter if it gets good.
And we asked her what she didn't like, and she said everything. You know, she didn't like anything out of the book. You know, there were a lot of positive stories in it. But stars do that, and Patty Chayefsky, he was the only writer to win 3 Oscars, and the only writer, screenwriter, to be allowed, you know, to have so much control, because most screenwriters aren't allowed on the set.
But did you meet him?
Oh, many times. I knew Patty in
New
York.
Oh, you did?
Yes.
Oh,
I see. Yes, I knew Patty, and always loved his work. From Marty in 1955, which I saw in Ireland, I loved his work. He was one of the best screenwriters. He had passion. He had wonderful dialogue, and he was fearless. You know?
Well, was he? He was very strong then.
Very strong.
Fit into your genre of strong.
Of those 3, yeah, sure.
Well,
yeah.
We didn't talk about Betty Davis. Did you know her?
Yes, I interviewed Betty Davis and Joan Crawford. And
to do the book?
No, Betty Davis to do the book, because Joan Crawford was dead then. She died in 77. Betty Davis called me from L.A. and did an interview. You know, and then I met her in New York. You know.
Did she trash Joan Crawford?
Well, yeah, she had some great stories. She had some great stories about Joan. Yes, that was a fun book. Yeah. Different book.
To put I want to get to Patty's book, because it's more current. But to put all these biographies together, do you just interview hundreds of people?
I think it was about, you know, let's say 150 people.
For the Barbara Streisand?
You do all the research, you go through all the documents, each and every book
for
is the same.
For each and every one.
My background as a journalist is what you do. You do all the research, you do the interviews. If they're there, you try to get them. And it takes a long time. Paddy Chayefsky took 4 years to do.
Well, he was a screenwriter. I don't think he was a name that people know like this.
Not like Tennessee Williams or not Arthur Miller's, but he won 3 Oscars. Marty, which you probably remember, was the first American movie to win at the Golden Palm at Cannes. Right now, Pulp Fiction just won this year for Bruce Willis. And Marty was the first American movie ever to win that award. And he was known. He was known in the 50s. But not like a star.
Well, when you met him and when you spent time with him, were you thinking about doing a book?
No. Patty, no, not at all. I was a traveling journalist then. I was writing for the New York Times then, and I would meet him. And I was in awe of him because in New York, he was like a big cult figure, and especially any writer or screenwriter. And that's why today for this book, I mean, there's so many aspiring screenwriters out there. That are taking all these courses, and that's what. Read this book, you'll find out how to write a script, and what's involved. And
did he teach?
Patty taught, at CCNY for a year.
He taught
screenwriting.
So.
Yes, he did. And Patty, as I said, the control. He always, and it wasn't just control for image sake. It was control of the work. And Patty said, if you believe in the work or believe in the script, you have to fight for it down along the line. So he had it in his contract that he had approval over casting, over directing, and the final cut, revisions. There were none of these 10 rewrite men or polish people coming in doing it.
He did it all.
Patty did it from the beginning to the end. And his control, very funny, Hospital, the movie with George C. Scott, this is when he took control beyond the norm. And when it was released in New York, he went out to Queens or Brooklyn to the movie theaters to see if the projection lenses were clean.
Is that right?
That's true.
So, I mean,
control can bring you over the edge.
He was a phenomenon.
Yes.
But he did go over the edge in a way, didn't he? I mean,
with
some of the things
states.
You were talking about, interviewing his son, Dan, where he said, I think it's something I remember, we're all chemicals in this glass together.
Yeah, this is
together.
The family, and they exploded, yes. You know, people pay, anybody that's into control or that put themselves up like that, it's very seductive. It really is. And I don't fault anybody for wanting it over their work, for you doing an interview or for Barbara Streisand
exactly.
and her records. It's fine, but you can go too far. And Patty met his Waterloo on Altered States, which is with Ken Russell, who was an English director they brought in. And he was concentrating on the visuals. And Patty, of course, was going for the sacred word. And they fought out here in L.A. And Patty, first movie he ever left.
He walked away?
He had to walk away, or they would have closed down this $16 million production.
So he was at least
But he
aware.
Went to New York, and they had to send him the rushes every day to look at the rushes, He was aware, for the good of the movie, he had to leave,
See, I think that's the part of your artisticness that you have to give up sometimes.
Yeah. You have to compromise. Can you live with it is the word. You have to walk away from it. It was hard for him, but that movie, it was like a three-year project for him.
But he didn't win an award for that, did he?
He took his name off of it.
Oh, that's
It was no longer his vision. It was Ken Russell's vision. He took his name off.
So he couldn't live with it.
No, he didn't.
Actually couldn't live with it.
He died within 9 months after it was released then.
You're kidding. Yeah. That was in 1981?
1981,
Wow.
And that movie's shown a lot. Never got the cult status of Network. But as I said, for screenwriters, to all the, it's a handbook for screenwriters.
So he wrote...
Marty, Academy Award. No. He wrote The Goddess, which was based on Marilyn Monroe. He wrote The Americanization of Emily, which was Patty's fight against the U.S. military. The Hospital, which was Patty's fight against the medical industry. Network, which was Patty's fight against the television industry. And Altered States, which was a satire on the scientific community.
He was actually, instead of writing newspaper articles and going on TV, he was making movies about these important issues to him.
Yeah.
Another important issue was his, even though he had an Irish name, where'd he get his Irish name?
He got it in the Army. When he was in the Army, he tried to get out of kitchen patrol. And the sergeant came in and said, who has to be excused for mass today? And Patty raised his hand. And the sergeant said, but yesterday you were excused for temple, for Jewish services. And he said, but my mother's Irish.
So he really did use
And the sergeant said, okay, Patty. And then Patty took the name because it gave him a license to fight. Sydney was his real name, and Sydney was Sydney.
Yeah.
But Patty was a name that you fight with,
That sounds...
Poetic license. That's how he got the name, and he liked the name.
But even though he had this funny Irish name, he had these deep, intense feelings for Israel.
All his life, yeah. His mother and father were Russian Jews, and they came out here early 1900s. And Patty was good Jewish boy. He went to temple, did all the good Jewish things, and he fought then for Israel, or lent his money and his time.
He did.
And fought Vanessa Redgrave on the Oscars, let's not forget that, which is Oscar history, when she called the, when she thanked the Academy for voting for her in spite of the Zionist hoodlums, is what
right.
she called them.
And what did he do then?
He went on 10 minutes later, and he gave a wonderful, eloquent speech without naming any names.
Just like that.
And he said, a simple thank you would have sufficed. And not to make this a political rostrum. That is Academy Oscar history.
Was he attracted to the women in his movies, or were the women attracted to him?
He was attracted to Marilyn Monroe. That's why he wrote, he was writing Middle of the Night for Monroe.
Did he know her?
Oh, yes, yes.
Did they
it's
have
all
an
in
affair?
The book. No, they didn't have an affair.
Did he have an affair with any of his leading ladies?
The second blonde femme fatale was Kim Novak on Middle of the Night, which Marilyn was supposed to do. And he had a romance with Kim Novak. Yes, he did. The only romance throughout the entire book.
Well, we know, we learned something from you just now. And a simple thank you will suffice. I will give you a simple thank you for being with us today. And I think I can't wait to get deeper into the life and work of Patty Chayefsky by Shawn Considine. Mad as hell.
Thank you, John.
Thank you. A simple thank you. And a simple thank you to all our viewers. Keep writing to us at 520 South Grand, and we'll see you next time on the Joan Quinn Profiles.